Welcome to the inaugural podcast of the Back of the Forties Classic. We are a group of recovered alcoholics who love sharing the history of the AA program. We are students of the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. We really believe in the program outlined in the Big Book and want to share it with anyone who may be afflicted with the disease of alcoholism. These five classes will take us through the 12 steps right out of the Big Book as they did in the early days of AA. If you want more information about these classes, please email us at backtothe40s@gmail.com. That's backtothe40s@gmail.com. Or visit backtothe40s.podbean.com. And in both those cases, Back to the 40s is completely spelled out. So grab your Big Book and let's join Michael, Mick, and Bob as they get these classes started.
And hello, I am an alcoholic, and my name is Michael.
Hey, Michael.
I am a recovered alcoholic, contingent on the maintenance of my spiritual condition. Let's have a moment of silence to reflect on why we're here, followed by the Serenity Prayer. God,
grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference.
I'd like to welcome you to the beginner's meetings, how Alcoholics Anonymous worked in the mid-1940s. More than 60 years ago, after the publication of the Big Book, the recovery rate from alcoholism within the Fellowship of AA was at about 75%. AA's program as practiced then was quite different from the program that is practiced today. That is, the AA program is unchanged, but the way it is practiced has changed. To produce such an astounding recovery rate back then, what was done in the early days of AA? Well, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take an in-depth look at how Alcoholics Anonymous worked in the mid-40s. I've asked Mick to read the AA preamble as appeared in the first edition of the Big Book in 1939, and it reads,
"We are not an organization in the conventional sense of the word. There are no fees or dues whatsoever. The only requirement for membership is an honest desire to stop drinking. We are not allied with any particular faith, sect, or denomination, nor do we oppose anyone. We simply wish to be helpful to those who are afflicted."
Hello, our names are Mick, Michael, and Bob, and we are recovered alcoholics, and that is contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition daily. We are not experts, nor are we authorities on the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. We are recovered alcoholics who love to study the Big Book. Any commentary that is made throughout this study is just our opinions based upon our interpretation of the Big Book. We do not need to open our books at this time, but we will let you know. On page 164 of the Big Book, it reads,
"Our book is meant to be suggestive only. We realize we know only a little. God will constantly disclose more to you and to us."
Before we begin this class, we'll need to address one more thing. There is always going to be controversy when it comes to this book and its message, for one reason or another. Some say it needs to be rewritten, changed, or updated, and then there is the God issue, that it is written in the male gender, and a whole lot of other controversial issues. It's as if we are saying the book should be changed to meet our personal agendas. On page Roman numeral XI, the book tells us,
"There exists a sentiment against any radical changes being made."
The point is, let's leave the book alone and change our own attitudes towards the book, and from that perspective, learn the recovery program that produced the 75% success rate back in the 1940s. This is how the presentations of these classes will work.
I will read from the 1944 pamphlet, and we can listen to what is being read, take notes, and if you have any questions, write them down. Submit them to your sponsor, or see one of us after the meeting and discuss them at length.
I will read excerpts from the Big Book, and you will follow along, using the line bookmarks.
I will read commentary to what is studied and give directions, page numbers, line numbers, or paragraph numbers. That is how these classes are taught. Now listen carefully as Michael reads a very interesting item.
This is the 12 Steps of Insanity, circa 1945. 1. We admitted we were powerless over nothing, that we could manage our lives perfectly and those of anyone else who would allow us. 2. Came to believe there was no power greater than ourselves and the rest of the world was insane. 3. made a decision to have our loved ones and friends turn their wills and lives over to our care, even though they couldn't understand us at all. 4, made a searching and fearless moral inventory of everyone we knew. 5, admitted to the world at large the exact nature of everyone else's wrongs. 6, were entirely ready to make others straighten up and do right. 7, demanded others either shape up or ship out. 8, made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to go to any lengths to get even with them all. 9, got direct revenge on such people wherever possible, except when to do so would cost us our own lives or at very least a jail sentence. 10, continued to take the inventory of others and when they were wrong promptly and repeatedly told them about it. 11, sought through bitching and nagging to improve our relations with others as we couldn't understand them all, asking only that they knuckle under and do things our way. 12, having had a complete physical, emotional, and spiritual breakdown as a result of these steps, we tried to blame it on others and get sympathy and pity in all of our affairs. These describe the practicing alcoholic. Can anyone identify with these? Do these steps sound familiar? Perhaps these 12 steps of insanity are so accurate, you could add your name to each and every one. We hear a lot of talk and ideas that alcoholism has changed over the years, or that things are different today, or AA needs to change with the times. The truth about statements like these is that the illness of alcoholism produces the exact same symptoms today that it has throughout the history of mankind. These 12 steps of insanity, if you are honest with yourself about them, give evidence beyond any doubt there is an irrefutable connection between alcoholism in the 1940s and alcoholism in the brand new 2010. It's precisely the same, and if that is fact, then the same solution to alcoholism must hold true also. Let's take a look at this solution and how it was achieved so we can recover today.
We're going back into AA's history to see how AA was practiced in the 1940s. The program most of us are being exposed to today is not that same program. We have lost touch with that program, which produced a 75% recovery rate. So let's reestablish that link with our AA past. It has been said that whatever a civilization or society declines or perishes, there is always one condition present. They forgot where they came from. Let's take a look at where the early AAs came from. In the 1940s, most people that came into AA went to introduction classes. That is what these 5 meetings are about. A basic classroom schoolbook study of the 12 steps of AA's program of recovery. To keep in step with the early AAs, we will be referring to the pamphlet titled Alcoholics Anonymous, an interpretation of our 12 steps, printed in September of 1944. This pamphlet is not conference approved. There was no conference and no traditions back in our history when this pamphlet and the big book were published and were being used. We will be taking the entire study of AA's 12 steps out of the book titled Alcoholics Anonymous, first published April 1st, 1939. Now let's listen to what the pamphlet has to say about the pamphlet.
This is the preface to the 1944 pamphlet. Preface. The following pages contain the basic material for the discussion meetings for alcoholics only. These meetings are held for the purpose of acquainting both old and new members with the 12 steps on which our program is based. So that all 12 steps may be covered in a minimum of time, they are divided into 5 classes. Thus, in a little over a month, anyone can get the basis of our 12 suggested steps. This is the disclaimer of the 1944 pamphlet. The material contained herein is merely an outline of the program, is not intended to replace or supplant these 6 major items.
Item A.
The careful reading and rereading of the big book.
Item B.
Regular attendance at weekly group meetings.
Item C.
Study of the program.
Item D.
Daily practice of the program.
Item E.
Reading of sponsor-approved printed material on alcoholism.
Item F.
Informal discussion with other members.
So, this is how it used to be back in the 1940s.
First,
You are sponsored through the 5 classes and completed the 12 steps right away, nonstop, out of the book, big book of Alcoholics Anonymous.
Second,
you became an active member of Alcoholics Anonymous. In other words, before you even went to a regular AA meeting, you have a sponsor and would have completed the program of recovery that is in the big book. You are a recovered alcoholic, contingent on the maintenance of your spiritual condition daily.
Third,
you sponsored newcomers through the classes and did this a couple of times, carrying AA's message only, keeping it pure. The program that is written down in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, period.
Fourth,
you taught the classes. That's why it worked. That's why so many people got sobriety and kept sobriety. There is no better way to learn to keep this program than to teach it. Let's listen as Michael reads from the 1944 pamphlet. Here the pamphlet tells us what our part must be if we want to pursue recovery from alcoholism.
This is titled Discussion Number 1, The Admission Phase. This meeting covers step number 1. We admitted we were powerless over alcohol and that our lives had become unmanageable. This instruction is not a shortcut to AA. It is an introduction, a help, a brief course in the fundamentals. In order to determine whether or not a person has drifted from social drinking into pathological drinking, it is well to consider, with the guidance of a sponsor, 3 questions which each member may ask and answer for himself. We must answer, once and for all, these 3 puzzling questions.
Number 1.
What is an alcoholic?
Number 2.
Who is an alcoholic?
Number 3.
Am I an alcoholic? To get the right answer, the prospective member must start this course of instruction with the 3 essentials for recovery.
Number 1.
A willingness to learn. We must not have the attitude, you've got to show me.
Number 2.
An open mind. Forget any and all ideas or notions we already have. Set our opinions aside.
3.
Here's a tough one. Complete honesty. It is possible, though not at all probable, that we may fool somebody else, but we must be honest with ourselves, and it's a good time to start being honest with others. Now let's open our books to page Roman numeral 11, second paragraph, to read what the big book has to say about the big book.
That's page Roman numeral 11, second paragraph, the preface.
Because this book has become the basic text for our society and has helped such large numbers of alcoholic men and women to recovery, there exists a sentiment against any radical changes being made in it. Therefore, the first portion of this volume, describing the AA recovery program,
which is the chapter, the doctor's opinion, in the first 103 pages,
has been left untouched.
The information in this book has helped large numbers of alcoholics to recovery. It is our textbook, and this textbook describes the AA recovery program. Go to page Roman numeral 13, line 1, to continue to read what the book says about the book.
And let's go to page Roman numeral 13, line 1, the foreword to the first edition, and it reads,
the foreword to the first edition. This is the foreword as it appeared in the first printing of the first edition in 1939. We of Alcoholics Anonymous are more than 100 men and women who have recovered from the seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. To show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this book. For them, we hope these pages will prove so convincing that no further authentication will be necessary.
The book tells us we can learn precisely how to recover from alcoholism in this book. The book is our teacher. This meeting is the classroom. We are the students. To show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this book. The word precisely means no variation. Now, there are a lot of interesting ideas about recovery from alcoholism floating around the rooms of AA. But, be forewarned, a lot of these interesting ideas are not in this book. Consider this. The early AAs pioneered this recovery program. They lived it first, worked out all the kinks, then wrote it down in this book. The program in this book works precisely the way it is outlined. The only thing we can add to this proven recovery program is action. Let's take another look at what the book says about the book. Go to page 17, last paragraph.
That's page 17, last paragraph, chapter 2, there is a solution.
The tremendous fact for every one of us is that we have discovered a common solution. We have a way out on which we can absolutely agree and upon which we can join brotherly and harmonious action. This is the great news this book carries to those who suffer from alcoholism.
The book tells us what we can absolutely agree upon, that the AA program is in this book. Our concern is that a lot of people don't know this or don't hear about AA's program. That is why we are using this book, for it carries the solution to alcoholism. Go to page 18, line 1, to read about our illness, and let's see if you can identify with this paragraph.
Go to page 18, line 1.
An illness of this sort, and we have come to believe it is an illness, involves those about us in a way no other human sickness can. If a person has cancer, all are sorry for him and no one is angry or hurt, but not so with the alcoholic illness. For with it, there it goes.
Now, let's take a look at some of the consequences of our alcoholism. Here, the book shows us 8 points to reflect upon. Number 1,
annihilation of all things worthwhile in life.
Number 2,
it engulfs all whose lives touch the sufferers.
3,
it brings misunderstanding.
4,
fierce resentment.
5,
financial insecurity.
Number 6,
disgusted friends and employers.
7,
warped lives of blameless children.
Number 8,
sad wives and parents. Anyone can increase the list.
Can you identify or maybe add to the list? Let's continue. Next paragraph.
We hope this volume will inform and comfort those who are or who may be affected. There are many.
So, the big book informs and comforts us. It's time for a pop quiz. Go to page 44, line 4.
That's page 44, line 4, chapter 4, We Agnostics.
444.
If, when you honestly want to, you find you cannot quit entirely, or if, when drinking, you have little control over the amount you take, you are probably alcoholic.
Let's read this again, but look at this in terms of a test of an alcoholic. Ask yourself these two questions, true or false, number 1.
If, when you honestly want to, you find you cannot quit entirely.
And number 2.
Or, if when drinking you have little control over the amount you take, you are probably alcoholic. If that be the case, you may be suffering from an illness which only a spiritual experience will conquer.
What we've just read tells us what constitutes an alcoholic. And it also tells us what the solution is, a spiritual experience. We are going to read and study about the spiritual solution because that is what is talked about throughout this whole book. Go to page 45, line 9, to read about the problem.
Page 45, line 9, and it reads,
lack of power. That was our dilemma. We had to find a power by which we could live, and it had to be a power greater than ourselves. Obviously. But where and how will we define this power? Well, that's exactly what this book is about. Its main object is to enable you to find a power greater than yourself, which will solve your problem.
What is its main object?
Its main object is to enable you to find a power greater than yourself, which will solve your problem. That means we have written a book which we believe to be spiritual as well as moral.
Moral, meaning truthful?
As it means, of course. That is, we are going to talk about God.
So you see, this book provides a spiritual solution to the illness of alcoholism. If lack of power is the problem, then we need to find the power to overcome powerlessness. The book tells us exactly where this power is to be found. Go to page 55, second paragraph.
Page 55, second paragraph.
Actually, we were fooling ourselves, for deep down in every man, woman, and child is the fundamental idea of God. It may be obscured by calamity, by pomp, by worship of other things, but in some form or other, it is there. For faith is a power greater than ourselves. And miraculous demonstrations of that power in human lives are facts as old as man himself. We finally saw that faith in some kind of God was part of our makeup, just as much as the feelings we have for a friend. Sometimes we had to search fearlessly, but he was there. He was as much a fact as we were. We found that the great reality deep down within us, in the last analysis, is that only there that he may be found. It was so with us.
To put this another way, in terms of the solution to our alcoholism, we are looking for a power greater than ourselves, and that power is inside of us. In terms of the problem, the book tells us that we were blocked off from this power. It tells us it may be obscured by calamity, by pomp, by worship of other things, first and foremost, alcohol. It blocks us off from the power. We are living on self-will by drinking alcohol. The whole idea is to get out from self-will, the problem, to God's will, the solution. Alcohol is blocking us. We will take care of that in step one. The other things that are blocking us off will be dealt with later on, so that we can break through the barrier of self-will and find out what God's plan is for us. Go to the title page.
The title page, found at the very front of the big book.
Alcoholics Anonymous, the story of how many thousands of men and women have recovered from alcoholism.
Have what?
Have recovered from alcoholism.
This is a powerful statement, but misunderstood. Notice the word recovered. It is not by mistake that it is mentioned. It is mentioned 23 times in this book.
It's trivia time. The word recovering is mentioned 2 times in the big book. It does not occur at all in the part of the text that has to do with the recovery program. Pages Roman numeral 23 through page 103. Whereas the word recovered is masterfully used 12 times within this part of the volume to describe the alcoholic who has completed the process of recovery and continues to persevere, to grow. Interesting fact, isn't it?
Let's look at what the word recovered means. The book tells us that there are 4 ways of categorizing the alcoholic.
Number 1.
The real alcoholic.
Number 2.
The dry alcoholic.
Number 3.
The recovering alcoholic.
4.
The recovered alcoholic. Go to page 21, line 8, to read about the real alcoholic. The book gives us 3 pieces of evidence, a test, if you will, of what qualifies an alcoholic.
Page 21, line 8, chapter 2, there is a solution.
But what about the real alcoholic?
Number 1.
He may start off as a moderate drinker.
Number 2.
He may or may not become a continuous hard drinker.
Number 3.
But at some stage of his drinking career, he begins to lose all control of his liquor consumption once he starts to drink.
So the question is, what happens to the real alcoholic after he takes the first drink? The answer, the second drink. And next, here are 11 points to consider. The next paragraph, same page. Just follow along, moving down the page.
Here is a fellow who has been puzzling.
Number 1.
Especially in his lack of control.
Number 2.
He does absurd, incredible, tragic things while drinking.
Number 3.
He is a real Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Number 4.
He is seldom mildly intoxicated. He is always more or less insanely drunk.
Number 5.
His disposition while drinking resembles his normal nature but little.
6.
He may be one of the finest fellows in the world, yet let him drink for a day, and he frequently becomes disgustingly and even dangerously antisocial.
7.
He has a positive genius for getting tight exactly at the wrong moment, particularly when some important decision must be made or engagement can be.
8.
He is often perfectly sensible and well-balanced concerning everything else except liquor, but in that respect he is incredibly dishonest and selfish.
9.
He often possesses special abilities, skills, and aptitudes, and has a promising career ahead of him. He uses his gifts to build up a bright outlook for his family and himself, and then pulls the structure down on his head by a senseless series of sprees.
10.
He's the fellow who goes to bed so intoxicated he ought to sleep the clock around. Yet early next morning he searches madly for the bottle he misplaced the night before.
11.
If he can afford it, He may have liquor concealed all about his house. He's certain no one gets his entire supply away from him to throw down the waste pipe.
Can anyone identify? This is the real alcoholic. Someone who does not have control over their drinking. A real Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I'm sure we all know this type of alcoholic. Go to page 151, the last paragraph, to continue to explore the four categories. And the book tells us about the dry alcoholic.
That's page 151, last paragraph, chapter 11, A Vision for You.
Now and then, a serious drinker, being dry at the moment, says, I don't miss it at all. I feel better, work better. I'm having a better time. And ex-problem drinkers, we smile at such a sally. We know our friend is like a boy whistling in the dark to keep up his spirits. He fools himself. Inwardly, he would give anything to take half a dozen drinks and get away with them. He will presently try the old game again, for he isn't happy about his sobriety.
Now, this means if we are not working and living AA's program of recovery, that just happens to be precisely shown to us in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, then we are dry, and we will try the old game again. If we are living with untreated alcoholism, next, we will read about the recovering alcoholic. The word recovering is clearly defined. Go to page 122, line 1. This is where the word recovering is mentioned. It is also mentioned on page 334. These are the only two places in the whole big book where the word occurs. Interesting, isn't it?
That was page 122, line 1, in chapter 9, The Family Afterwards.
Our women folk have suggested certain attitudes a wife may take with the husband who is recovering.
Go to the last page, go to the last paragraph on this page, and one of these attitudes is the stopping of drinking or
cessation of drinking is but the final step away from a highly strained, abnormal condition.
For the definition of the recovering alcoholic, go to page 127, line 2.
That was page 127, line 2, and it reads,
the alcoholic, though marvelously improved, is still convalescent. He should be thankful he is sober and able to be of this world once more. Let them praise his progress. Let them remember that his drinking wrought all kinds of damage that may take long to repair. If they sense these things, they will not take so seriously his periods of crankiness, depression, or apathy, which will disappear when there is tolerance, love, and spiritual understanding.
So, what we just read from page 122 tells us that there is more to the solution to our alcoholism than just stopping drinking. Just stopping is only the first step away from the problem and only part of the first step to the solution. The definition reads, from page 127, recovering is marvelously improved, convalescing, sober, able, progress, may take long to repair periods of crankiness, depression, or apathy. It also says these things will disappear when there is spiritual understanding. Now let's read the definition of recovered. Let's take a very close look at what it means to be a recovered alcoholic. There are 18 points to consider. Go to the bottom of page 84, the last paragraph.
That's page 84, last paragraph, chapter 6, End Action.
Number 1.
And we have ceased fighting anything or anyone, even alcohol.
2.
For by the time sanity will have returned.
3.
We will seldom be interested in liquor.
4.
If tempted, we recoil from it as a hot flame.
Number 5.
We react sanely and normally.
6.
And we will find that this has happened automatically.
7.
We will see that our new attitude towards liquor has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. It just comes. That is the miracle.
Number 8.
We are not fighting it. Neither are we avoiding temptation.
9.
We feel as though we have been placed in a position of neutrality, safe and protected.
10.
We have not even sworn off.
11.
Instead, problem has been removed.
Number 12.
It does not exist for us.
13.
We are neither cocky nor are we afraid.
14.
That's how we act, so long as we keep it in spiritual condition.
15.
It is easy to let up on our spiritual program of action and rest on our laurels.
16.
We are headed for trouble if we do, for alcohol is a subtle foe.
17.
We are not cured of alcoholism.
Number 18.
What we really have is a daily reprieve, contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition.
Let me offer the group an analogy about the recovered alcoholic. Take the gunshot victim, for example. He gets shot, goes through a period of recovery, survives the affliction, is recovered from the gunshot, but is not bulletproof. Get the idea? Interesting, isn't it? This is the mindset, attitudes, and definition of the recovered alcoholic. Sane, neutral, safe, protected, and in fit spiritual conditions. We are not cured from alcoholism. What we really have is a daily reprieve contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition. We have broken down the alcoholic into four categories, and the question is, which category do you fit into?
Number one.
The real alcoholic.
Number two.
The dry alcoholic.
Number three.
The recovering alcoholic.
Number four.
The recovered alcoholic. Go to the page marked contents. As we continue to study, let's keep in mind that the big book is written in such a way that it assumes the reader knows nothing about the subject, recovery from alcoholism.
Page number, Roman numeral 5, found in the very front of the big book.
We will be covering steps 1 through 12 in these four classes, which are found in the big book. Pages Roman numeral 23 through 103. This is AA's program of recovery from alcoholism. 111 pages are broken down into three main parts. The contents give an outline theme. The doctor's opinion, beginning on page Roman numeral 23, chapter 1, the spill story.
These discuss the problem, lack of power, and alcoholism.
Chapter 2, there is a solution. Chapter 3, more about alcoholism. Chapter 4, we agnostic.
These discuss the solution, a God, the power to overcome powerlessness.
Chapter 5, how it works. Chapter 6, into action. Chapter 7, working with others, ending on page 103.
These discuss AA's program, the 12 steps, or the action necessary to recover. How to find that power, use it, and keep it. Go to page Roman numeral 26, first paragraph, to read what the doctor's opinion states about our alcoholism.
That was page Roman numeral 26, first paragraph. If you're in the fourth edition, it's page Roman numeral 28.
We believe, and so suggested a few years ago, that the action of alcohol on these chronic alcoholics is a manifestation of an allergy, that the phenomenon of craving is limited to this class and never occurs in the average temperament drinker. These allergic types can never safely use alcohol in any form at all, and once having formed that habit and found they cannot break it, once having lost their own self-confidence, their reliance upon these things human, their problems pile up on them and become astonishingly difficult to solve.
The doctor tells us, in terms of the physical aspect of our alcoholism, we have a physical allergy to alcohol and a physical craving as a direct result of consuming alcohol. So why do we drink? Let's see if anyone can identify with these eight symptoms. The last paragraph on this page tells us, number one,
men and women drink essentially because they like the effect produced by alcohol.
Yep. Number two,
the sensation is so elusive that while they admit it is injurious, they cannot, after a time, differentiate true from the false.
Number three,
to them, their alcoholic life seems the only normal one.
Number four,
they are restless, irritable, and discontented.
Number five,
unless they again can experience the sense of ease and comfort which comes at once by taking a few drinks which they see others taking with impunity.
Six,
after they have succumbed to the desire again, as too many do, and the phenomenon of craving develops, they pass through the well-known stages of esprit.
7.
Emerging, remorseful, with a firm resolution not to drink again.
8.
This is repeated over and over
and over. Can anyone identify? Let's continue with the same line, and the doctor offers a glimpse of the solution.
And unless this person can experience an entire psychic change, there's very little hope of his recovery.
Consider this. There are many reasons for taking a drink, and many reasons for continuing to drink. One thing for sure. When it comes to alcoholics, we have one thing in common. We absolutely cannot start drinking without developing the phenomenon of craving. Now let's explore this phenomenon a little further. The last paragraph on this page reads,
I do not hold with those who believe that alcoholism is entirely a problem of mental control. I have had many men who had, for example, worked a period of months on some problem or business deal which was to be settled on a certain date, favorably to them. They took a drink a day or so prior to the date, and then the phenomenon of craving at once became paramount to all other interests, so that important appointment cannot be met. These men were not drinking to escape, they were drinking to overcome a craving beyond their mental control. What? These men were not drinking to escape, they were drinking to overcome a craving beyond their mental control. There are many situations which arise out of the phenomenon of craving, which cause men to make the supreme sacrifice rather than to continue to fight.
Next, the doctor tells us about the classifications of the alcoholic. He describes in brief 5 types. Let's continue reading, starting with the 2nd paragraph on the same page, and just follow along reading down the page.
The classification of alcoholics seems more difficult and in much detail is outside the scope of this book.
1.
There are, of course, the psychopaths who are emotionally unstable. We are all familiar with this type. They are, as always, going on the wagon for keeps. They are over-remorseful and make many resolutions, but never a decision.
2.
There is a type of man who is unwilling to admit that he cannot take a drink. He plans various ways of drinking. He changes his brand or his environment.
3.
There is a type who always believes that after being entirely free from alcohol for a period of time, he can take a drink without danger.
4.
There is the manic depressive type, who is perhaps the least understood by his friends, and whom about a whole chapter could be written.
5.
Then there are types entirely normal in every respect except in the effect alcohol has upon them. They are often able, intelligent, friendly people.
So, which type are you?
1.
The one who is always going on the wagon for keeps.
2.
The one who is unwilling to admit.
3.
The one who abstains for a while.
4.
The least understood type.
5.
The one who is entirely normal but affected. Go to the next to the last paragraph on the same page. The doctor tells us in summary.
All these and many others have one symptom. They cannot start drinking without developing the phenomenon of craving. This phenomenon, as we have suggested, may be the manifestation of an allergy which differentiates these people and sets them apart as a distinct entity. It has never been, by any treatment with which we are familiar, permanently eradicated.
So, we cannot start drinking without developing the phenomenon of craving. We have an allergy to alcohol. But that is not the whole story. Let's read about the mental component of our alcoholism. Go to page 30, line 1.
Page 30, line 1, chapter 3, more about alcoholism.
Most of us have been unwilling to admit we were real alcoholics. No person likes to think he is bodily and mentally different from his fellows. Therefore, it is not surprising that our drinking careers have been characterized by countless vain attempts to prove we could drink like other people. The idea that somehow, someday, we will control and enjoy his drinking is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker. The persistence of this illusion is astonishing. Many pursue it into the gates of insanity or death.
Not only are we unwilling to admit that we are bodily and mentally different, vain, obsessive, abnormal, and delusional, we must be insane because we shouldn't be drinking alcohol, but our minds tell us it's okay to drink. That is what kills so many alcoholics. The mental obsession that someday, somehow, some way, they will be able to drink normally. It's never going to happen. Go back to page Roman numeral 28. Count six lines up from the bottom to get a glimpse of step one.
That's page Roman numeral 28 in the third edition, six lines up from the bottom. If you're in the fourth edition, it's Roman numeral page 30.
The only relief we have to suggest is entire abstinence.
Skip down two lines.
The general opinion seems to be that the most chronic alcoholics are doomed.
These two medical opinions from the 1940s were true then and are true today. So, we have established that as alcoholics, we have a physical allergy and a mental obsession, and this illness leaves us doomed. Let's sum this up by looking at two points of major importance.
Number one.
The fact for alcoholics.
Number two.
The main problem for alcoholics. Go to page 24, first paragraph. This is the fact for alcoholics.
That was page 24, first paragraph. In chapter 2, there is a solution.
The fact is that most alcoholics, for reasons yet obscure, have lost the power of choice in drink. Our so-called willpower becomes practically non-existent. We are unable, at certain times, to bring into our consciousness with sufficient force the memory of the suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago. We are without defense against the first drink. Repeat. I will. We are without defense against the first drink.
Go back to page 23 to read about the main problem for us alcoholics. Count down five lines from the top of the page.
And that's page 23, five lines down from the top.
The main problem of the alcoholic centers in his mind rather than in his body.
Did you know that for most alcoholics, Skid Row is between our ears? Here's a little trivia again. Did you know that the word I is mentioned 7,214 times in this book? We are going to go through the steps and recover from this hopeless state of I and hopeless state of mind and body. In Bill's story, chapter 1, we will briefly explore the problem as well as the solution.
In overview, Bill describes his recovery process. He was a low-bottom drunk. He was hopeless. He had been in the hospital for detox three times. Prior to his final trip in December of 1934, he had not worked in years. His wife supported him. All he did was drink. Some of us might say, I never went down that far, or I was never that bad. When it comes to alcoholism, this attitude of being unique can kill. AA is not about comparing or competition. You can save those attitudes for the sports arena. The key here is similarities. Listen and identify. For it is the things that we have in common that will aid us on the road to recovery. Bill took the steps in chapter 1. Let's look carefully and we will see the essence of the 12 steps in Bill's personal recovery. Go to page 8, line 8, Bill's first step.
That was page 8, line 8, and it reads,
no words can tell the loneliness and despair I found in the bitter morass of self-pity. Quicksand stretched all around me in every direction. I had met my match. I had been overwhelmed. Alcohol was my master.
Go to page 12, fourth paragraph, Bill's second step.
That was page 12, fourth paragraph, and it reads,
it was only a matter of being willing to believe in a power greater than myself. Nothing more was required of me to make my beginning. I saw that growth could start from that point.
And on page 13, Bill takes the rest of the steps with his sponsor, Abby Thatcher, at the Towns Hospital, New York, in December of 1934. We will start with the second paragraph and continue through the rest of the page. Just follow along moving down the page. Step 3.
There, I humbly offered myself to God, as I then understood Him to do with me as He would. I placed myself unreservedly under His care and direction. I admitted for the first time that of myself I was nothing, that without Him I was lost.
Same line, step 4.
I ruthlessly faced my sins.
Same line, steps 6 and 7.
And became willing to have this newfound friend take them away, root and branch.
Next paragraph, step 5.
I fully acquainted Him with my problems and deficiencies.
Same line, step 8.
We made a list of people I had hurt or toward whom I felt resentment.
Same line, step 9.
I expressed my entire willingness to approach these individuals, admitting my wrong. Never was I to be critical of them. I was to right all such matters to the utmost of my ability.
Next paragraph, step 10.
I was to test my thinking by this new God consciousness within.
Next line, step 11.
I was to sit quietly, when in doubt, asking only for direction and strength to meet my problems as He would have.
Next paragraph, step 12.
My friend promised when these things were done, I would enter upon a new relationship with my Creator, and I would have the elements of a way of living which answered all my problems.
Turn to page 14, second paragraph. Bill describes his spiritual experience.
That was page 14, second paragraph, and it reads,
"These were revolutionary and drastic proposals. But the moment I fully accepted them, the effect was electric. It was a sense of victory, followed by such a peace and serenity I had never known. It was utter confidence. I felt lifted up, as though the great clean wind of a mountaintop blew through and through. God comes to most men gradually, but His impact on me was sudden and profound."
Let's look at this process in terms of timing. Bill checked into Towns Hospital in New York on December 11, 1934, and was discharged on December 18, 1934. This means he was detoxed, completed the steps with his sponsor, and had a spiritual awakening in 7 days.
Now, there were no 12 steps at that time. There were 6 tenets or beliefs from the Oxford group that our 12 steps of today are based upon. At this time, we'll pass around the room a copy of the 6 original steps in Bill's handwriting and a copy of Bill's discharge record from Towns Hospital, New York. If you want to know more about the 6 original steps, they are found on page 292 in the 3rd edition of the Big Book and on page 263 in the 4th edition.
The point is, Bill wrote this book. He wrote this book on how to take the steps and when to take the steps. Bill never drank again. This idea of taking a step a year, or don't bother with the steps your first year, or just do the steps whenever or however you want, and a whole lot of do-it-yourself methods and interesting ideas about the steps, none of which are in this book. What is in this book is precise directions, requirements, timelines, and promises for each individual step. Let's follow these carefully so we can complete the process and bring about the psychic change sufficient enough to produce our recovery from alcoholism. Next, let's listen as Michael reads a summary from the 1944 pamphlet. This reading condenses everything we have studied up to this point and brings the study to 2 alternatives and 12 points of resolve.
This is titled, "We Admit." If, after carefully considering the foregoing, we admit we are an alcoholic, we must realize that, once a person becomes a pathological drinker, he can never again become a controlled drinker, and, from that point on, is limited to just 2 alternatives.
Alternative number 1.
Total permanent abstinence.
Alternative number 2.
Chronic alcoholism with all the handicaps and penalties it implies. In other words, we have gone past the point where we have choice. All we have left is a decision to make. We resolve to do something about it. And here we have the 12 points of resolve.
Number one.
We must change our way of thinking.
Number two.
We must realize that each morning when we awake, we are potential drunkards for that day.
Number three.
We resolve that we will practice AA for the 24 hours of that day.
Number four.
We must study the other 11 steps of the program and practice all the spiritual principles of the 12 steps in all our affairs.
Number five.
Attend the regular group meeting each week without fail.
Number six.
Firmly believe that by practicing AA faithfully each day, we will achieve sobriety.
Number seven.
Believe that we can be free from alcohol as a problem.
Eight.
This is important. Contact another member before taking a drink, not after. Tell him what bothers you. Talk it over with him freely.
Nine.
Work the program for ourselves alone, not for our wife, children, friends, or for our job.
Number 10.
Be absolutely honest and sincere.
11.
Be fully open-minded, no mental reservations.
12.
Be fully willing to work the program. Nothing good in life comes without work. Go to page 30, second paragraph for step 1. And that's page 30, second paragraph in chapter 3. More about alcoholism.
Here the book gets to the heart of step one. We are shown six requirements to step one. Number one,
We learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we were alcoholics. This is the first step in recovery.
Number two,
the delusion that we are like other people, or presently may be, has to be smashed.
Number three,
we alcoholics are men and women who have lost the ability to control our drinking.
Number four,
we know that no real alcoholic ever recovers control. All of us felt at times that we were gaining control, but such intervals, usually brief, were inevitably followed by still less control, which led in time to pitiful and incomprehensible demoralization.
Number five,
we are convinced to a man that alcoholics of our type are in the grip of a progressive illness.
Number six,
over any considerable period, we get worse, never better.
Let's continue to study some conclusions about step one. Next paragraph, same page, there are eight conclusions. Number one,
we are like men who have lost their legs. They never grow new ones.
Number two,
neither does there appear to be any kind of treatment which will make alcoholics of our kind like other men.
Number three,
we have tried every imaginable remedy.
Number four,
in some instances, there has been brief recovery, followed by a still worse relapse.
Number five.
Physicians who are familiar with alcoholism agree there is no such thing as making a normal drinker out of an alcoholic. Science may accomplish this, but it hasn't done so yet.
Number six.
Despite all we can say, many who are real alcoholics are not going to believe that they are in that class.
Number seven.
By every form of self-deception and experimentation, they will try to prove themselves exceptions to the rule, therefore non-alcoholic.
Number eight.
If anyone who is showing inability to control his drinking can do the right about face and drink like a gentleman, our hat's off to him. Heaven knows we have tried hard enough and long enough to drink like other people.
Do you fully concede? Have you learn your lesson when it comes to alcohol? And have you admitted these conclusions to yourself? Have you achieved self-honesty? Number one.
We learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we were alcoholics.
Number two.
That the delusion that we were like other people, or presently may be, has to be smashed.
Number three.
Have lost the ability to control our drinking.
Number four.
That no real alcoholic ever recovers control.
Number five.
That alcoholics of our type are in the grip of a progressive illness.
Number six.
Over any considerable period, we get worse, never better.
If we can identify with these statements and honestly believe them to be the truth about ourselves and our lives, in other words, with the spiritual principle of self-honesty, then this is who we are. Then the timeline and requirements for step one have been met. But if we are not convinced of step one, then let's read from pages 31 and 32 and you can draw your own conclusions beginning with the last paragraph on page 31.
And that was page 31, last paragraph, and it reads,
"We do not like to pronounce any individual an alcoholic, but you can quickly diagnose yourself. Step over to the nearest bar room and try some controlled drinking. Try to drink and stop abruptly. Try it more than once. It will not take long for you to decide if you are honest with yourself about it. It may be worth a bad case of jitters if you get a full knowledge of your condition.
What we want to do right now is ask the group, are we ready to take step one? It is decision-making time, yes or no. We have explored the requirements and timeline for step one and the directions read from page 59. We admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. Let's read all together now.
I am powerless over alcohol and could not manage my own life.
That's it. That's step one, right out of the big book. But we are promised something as a result of step one. Go to page 58, line 1. This is the first step promise.
Rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path. Those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. Usually men and women who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. They are such unfortunates. They are not at fault. They seem to have been born that way. They are naturally incapable of grasping and developing a manner of living which demands rigorous honesty. Their chances are less than average. There are those, too, who suffer from grave emotional and mental disorders, but many of them do recover if they have the capacity to be honest.
We are promised that rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path, and that many of them do recover if they have the capacity to be honest. And on page 59, line 5, we have the first step prayer.
We ask His protection and care with complete abandon.
In summary, step one is that we conclude and concede to our innermost selves that we are alcoholic and that we are the problem and the road we took in life developed into a total mess. Step one is discovering who we are an alcoholic. Step one is self-honesty.
Now, nowhere in the big book does it tell us to stop drinking.
Yep.
But if we are powerless, have met our match, have been overwhelmed, and alcohol is our master, then in no way, shape, or form can we drink alcohol successfully. Nor can we not drink alcohol successfully. We are powerless and beyond human aid on both sides of the fence. To drink or not to drink is simply impossible for us. Remember, alcoholism comes in people, not in bottles.
And that leaves us with an obvious suspicion and a major question to be answered. If we cannot, and nothing human can, what's the solution to all this? The solution is simple and easy. Take all the rest of the steps as soon as possible, immediately, nonstop, until they are completed. Do the best you can with what you have, no matter with your present circumstances.
The most important thing is that we do not need to understand all of this 12-step stuff, nor do we need to feel good about ourselves to our life situations in order to complete the 12 steps. We simply do not get sobriety or keep sobriety on what we think or and or feel about all this AA stuff. We get sobriety and keep sobriety by one thing only, action. It's action through, with, and in the 12 steps with the guidance of a sponsor and the program that's in the big book. So, we get active first in the steps while attending meetings as a secondary priority. Then as time passes, we will begin to feel better, think better, and live the good life. A life of spiritual understanding, growth, and effectiveness. So in summary,
first,
we imitate.
Second,
we feel better.
Third,
we think better.
Fourth,
we live better. And
fifth,
we repeat the process of the rest of our lifetime in steps 10, 11, and 12. Then we are recovered alcoholics. We receive the gift of sobriety and keep the sobriety. contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition daily.
Next week's class will be steps 2, 3, 4, and 5. Homework for this class is read and discuss with your sponsor the chapter, The Doctor's Opinion, and pages 1 through 43. This way you will be current with the class when we move on from step 1. If you have any questions or comments or points of discussion, talk with your sponsor. That's the end of this class.